If you travel to outback Australia today, you'll be faced with a flat, arid landscape. This landscape feels ancient, like it's been unchanged for millions of years. But the truth is, this landscape has undergone dramatic environmental changes. In fact, if you were to travel back in time to between 140 and 99 million years ago, you would find yourself at the bottom of an inland sea. Back then, the locations of outback towns, such as Eromanga, were underwater. This is because the lowlands of Australia had become flooded by rising sea levels. Sea levels would rise and fall throughout the early Cretaceous period. As a result, there was not just one inland sea in central Australia, but rather five phases of shallow seas. These shallow seas are sometimes collectively referred to as the Eromanga Sea, or the Eromanga Seaway. You probably wouldn't want to take a dip though. These shallow seas were home to giant marine reptiles. Hi folks, Andrew here. Welcome to Prehistoric Australia. In today's episode, we're going to take a deep dive to discover what happened to Australia's inland seas. In today's episode, we're just going to focus on the first inland sea. Now, the Eromanga Sea first flooded central Australia around 140 million years ago, during the early Cretaceous period. Our knowledge of these inland seas comes from geologists studying volcanic and sedimentary rocks in Queensland, New South Wales, and South Australia. Sedimentary rocks that represent marine deposits have been dated to between 140 and 99 million years ago. That's a lot of time, around 40 million years of history. In other words, geologists have to study more than one geological formation to understand where and when there were inland seas in Australia. It's thanks to geologists and paleontologists that we know the story of the Eromanga Seas. So, big question, how did the Eromanga Sea form? Well, first, the Eromanga Sea needed a basin. Now, I like to think of a basin as like a geological bathtub. Similar to bathtubs, basins have sloped sides that have the potential to hold water and sediment. Basically, Australia wasn't going to contain a sea without a basin. Luckily, a basin did form in the late Triassic period. This basin is called the Great Australian Basin. It represented a number of basins that were linked together across the country. It existed until the late Cretaceous period. So, the Great Australian Basin was formed. All it needed to become a sea was water. So how did the Great Australian Basin become the Eromanga Sea? Well, during the early Cretaceous period, 140 million years ago, the supercontinents of Laurasia and Gondwana were splitting apart into the modern day continents. As the continents split apart, new oceanic crust thrust up between them. These underwater mountain ranges are called mid-ocean ridges. Now imagine if you could push up on the bottom of your bathtub at home. Where would the water go? Obviously, the water would flow over the sides. Likewise, these new, hot, mid-ocean ridges pushed up sea levels and flooded the lowlands. As a result, the Great Australian Basin was flooded and became the Eromanga Sea. But sea levels didn't remain the same. Global sea levels rose and fell over the next 40 million years. So the big question is, how much did these global sea levels impact the Eromanga Sea? To answer this question, let's look at the geological evidence. The marine deposits which date back to this time are difficult to interpret because there are lots of breaks in the patterns of these sedimentary layers. This means that more studies are needed to comprehensively examine this complexity. Bearing that in mind, at present there are two competing theories. One theory is that the Eromanga Sea never completely retreated. In other words, the Eromanga Sea was one inland sea, which waxed and waned a little bit, but overall remained in place for 40 million years. The other theory is that the Eromanga Sea represents a series of inland seas. These series flooded and retreated as global sea levels rose and fell. This created not one Eromanga Sea, but five distinct phases of the Eromanga Sea. From my research, it seems like this second theory is better represented by the geological evidence. So that is the theory that I will be discussing at length in this episode. The first inland sea took place between 140 and 125 million years ago. Marine rocks from the Kadnaoi formation of Queensland are dated to this time. The shallow sea was only a narrow strip, beginning in northern Queensland and extending to northern New South Wales and eastern South Australia. There's not much fossil evidence from the Kadnaoi formation, and the reason for this is simple. Most of the rocks simply haven't risen to the surface, so there's not much for paleontologists to look at. The reason for this is because the first two inland seas represent the deepest rock layers out of the five inland seas that occurred. Microfossils help date the first inland sea. Microfossils included pollens, spores, single-celled plants called dinoflagellates, and the biggest, ammonites. One ammonite which lived in the first inland sea was Hatteroceras lakefieldens. Ammonites are an extinct group of cephalopods related to squid and octopus. They were carnivorous and lived in spiraled shells, which they used to control buoyancy and propel themselves through the water. They were one of the most successful marine groups during the age of dinosaurs and are a signature fossil of this time. Despite the lack of fossil evidence, we also know that the first inland sea would have been inhabited by marine reptiles because their remains have been found all over the world, including similar shallow sea environments. They would have also been present in the second inland sea, which was just around the corner. So, the first inland sea had come and gone as global sea levels rose and fell. But the global sea levels would soon rise again. A second inland sea flooded Central Australia 125 million years ago. This inland sea would see dramatic events, such as not one, but two massive meteor strikes. Join us next time for part two, where you will learn about the rare fossils and dramatic events of the second inland sea.